Good morning, everybody. Welcome to another Sunday here at Northwest Community Church. This is the third Sunday of Advent. It's so good to see you all again. Let's kick this off with some worship. Feel free to sing along. It's a tune you know. Amen. Wasn't that fun? At this time, we will have the lighting of the Advent candle by the Price family. Take it away.
Welcome to West Community Church.
We are the Price family, minus one. Benny is speaking, but he's sending his best regards. We will be discussing week three of Advent, which is wonderfully titled Deck the Halls. We will be reading from Isaiah 61, 1 through 4, and Isaiah 61, 8 through 11 so far, should you want to read along with us. Isaiah 61, 1 through 4. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. They will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. They will renew the ruined cities that have been devastated for generations. Next, we will be reading from Isaiah 61, 8 through 11. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. In my faithfulness, I will reward my people and make an everlasting covenant. Their descendants will be known among the nations, and their offspring among the people. All who see them will acknowledge that they are the people the Lord has blessed. I delight greatly in the Lord. My soul rejoices in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation and arrayed me in a robe of his righteousness. As a bridegroom adorns his head like a priest, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the soil makes the sprout come up, and a garden causes seeds to grow, so the sovereign Lord will make righteousness and praise spring up before all nations. Next, Caden will be reading from John 1, 6 through 8.
He was a man sick from confusion. He came out of the wilderness to touch the confusion that might smell food and all that would be himself.
Awesome, Kevin. Thank you. And Dexter will be reading from John 1, 19 through 28.
Now, this was John's testimony when the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. He did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Messiah." They asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Finally, they said, "Who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John replied in the words of Isaiah, the prophet, "I am the voice of one calling in the wilderness. Make straight the way for the Lord." Now the Pharisees who had been sent questioned him, "Why then do you baptize if you are not the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" "I baptize with water," John replied, "but among you stands one you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie." This all happened at Bethany, on the other side of the Jordan, where John was baptized.
Thank you, Dexter. Please join us as we light our Advent candle as Caden and Dexter begin the reading.
This is Deck the Halls. We want everything to look nice. The decorations of the season, our homes with their lights and tinsels, wreaths and ribbons. We want to lighten the darkness around us. Bring beauty to the ugliness that wears us down. We decorate because it is traditional, because it lifts our hearts, because it makes us feel like children again. We deck our halls because company is coming.
The prophet Isaiah smiled when he said, "God will give and grow instead of the ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, a natural of praise instead of an ancient no matter how we feel, from the spirit of the saints, so long as we can decorate us with the Lord.
Love. We light these candles as a sign of our joy in the beautiful things of this season. Not just the good things that glitter and flash, but the deeper things, the beauty of the heart and the soul, the beauty of love shared in service and hospitality. We light this candle of joy because company is coming.
Oh come, Emmanuel. Thank you so much for joining our family, Northwest Community Church. From our families to yours, we wish you the happiest of holidays. Take
care. Make sure to give Jaira a happy birthday.
You took my place and set me free while I stayed in sin. You took me in. Joy in my heart forever, joy. of heaven. Christ is our joy forever. Joy in my heart forever. Joy in my heart forever. Joy in the song of heaven. Christ be our joy forever. 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 Christ be our joy forever.
We're so glad that you've joined us this morning for worship at Northwest. Would you pray with me? God, we are thankful that we can have joy today because you came and you changed everything in your coming. And as we get closer and closer to Christmas, our expectations are rising and we're looking for you. God, we thank you for this time of year when we can focus on you and really prepare for your coming. God, thank you for the Price family that lit the candle this morning. We just thank you for all of the individuals that consider Northwest Community Church their home. We just pray your covering over them, your safety during these times of intensity with this pandemic. I just pray for your safety and care and protection over Northwest. I pray for your care and safety and protection over our city and the surrounding counties and regions. That, Lord, you would bring an end to this pandemic. God, we're thankful, though, that even in the midst of very difficult moments, that we can still have joy, that the sort of joy you give us is the sort of joy that lasts. And what an incredible God that you would care about us enough to fill us up with your Spirit so that we can have that sense of hope that everything's going to be okay. Even when the news reports might tell us otherwise. God, you are awesome and incredible. And when we rehearse the Christmas story, we're just reminded that you're also creative in how you came to this earth. And you took us by surprise. And you continue to surprise us, God. God, I pray today that we would open up our hearts to you to receive what you would have us to receive today. God, forgive us for making our faith about things that can change and our own preferences and routines. God, as we talk today about just kind of getting back to that simple faith, I pray, Lord, that you would pierce our hearts. Help us, God, to repent of the things that we need to repent to. And as we repent, as we turn away, that we would turn fully towards you today. And so, God, our hearts are open. Would you speak to us through this story of your coming today? And I pray, God, that every person that's listening would be touched and would hear what they need to hear today, Lord. God, we are thankful that you have sustained us as a church over these months. We're thankful that you are still in control, that you're still God, and you're still answering prayers. And we're thankful that you hear this prayer, even as we pray this morning, in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Again, welcome to worship. We're so glad that you're with us. Christmas gets closer and closer. My wife and I had a little disagreement about how close Christmas was. And I said, honey, look over at the Advent wreath. We've already lit two candles. And we're about to light the third. And Advent is sort of a reminder as we lit that third candle today that we're literally a week away from the last Sunday of Advent and then Christmas Eve. Today, I want to just wish some happy birthdays, as we often do or try to do every Sunday. We missed one last week. We want to wish Leslie Wingender a belated happy birthday. Her birthday was on December the 7th. Happy birthday, Leslie. We want to wish Gloria a happy birthday. Her birthday is tomorrow. Happy birthday, Gloria. And Dawn Alvarez, Nita's daughter, her birthday is December 18th. Happy birthday, Dawn. We're so proud of what God is doing in and through you. And at this time, kids, the lesson for this week is up and ready for you. The lesson this week is on the topic that God is forever. That God is forever. He doesn't change. He's always there for us. And so you are invited to go check that out now, or if you do it later with your parents, but it is ready for you. We're going to be reading today in Luke, the second chapter, and looking at the first seven verses. So if you want to open your Bibles and get ready, we'll be reading that passage in just a few moments. Friends, believe it or not, today marks the nine-month anniversary of the Sunday that we closed for the very first time. So it's been a little over 9 months since we've been able to gather in this facility, since I've been up here preaching and actually had people looking back at me. And what a strange 6 months it's been. Remember back in March when things closed and we all thought, all right, we're going to, you know, maybe be out of school and out of work a few weeks and then things will get back to normal. And yet the weeks have drug on, and now we're talking now in terms of months and months instead of weeks. And I know, like many of you, my weeks are filled with these Zoom chats and social distancing and sitting with my kids who are still doing virtual learning. I've also learned, along with Liliana, way too much about live streaming and video production than I ever wanted or needed to know over these past several months. I never thought I would hear my daughter, you know, running the live stream and saying, giving us a countdown to start the service. Something I never thought I would hear. By the way, while I'm thinking about it, about 6 weeks ago, we invited Kenny Chatters, and many of you know Kenny. Kenny and Holly were here at Northwest for a number of years, and Kenny is now doing our video editing, and so whether you realized it or not, every Sunday you're seeing his handiwork as he splices and dices and puts our videos together and makes them smooth. So thank you, Kenny, for the work that you're doing. I also wanted to mention today that as this has gone on, we realize that we have continually tried to up our game in terms of our live stream experience, because we know that sitting at home, your only interaction with us is through that TV or device, and so we want to make sure that it's not distracting and that it's as enjoyable as possible as we worship. And so we applied and received a grant through our local district for new camera equipment. So today we're actually recording for the first time ever in full HD video. And so you're gonna see like all my wrinkles and gray hair now, which is a little worrisome. But you're gonna see how beautiful and handsome the rest of our staff and volunteers and worship team are. So I just wanted to celebrate that change with you today, and hopefully you see a difference. But church life is really different. Like, I just miss walking through those doors and smelling the coffee, and Susie or Aaron or one of our volunteers would have gotten here and gotten the coffee started, and then being able to greet and engage with those that have come a little early on a Sunday morning. Being able to engage with families and your children and see them grow up. When I see Caden on that video this morning, I'm like, whoa, Caden has grown so much over these last few months. I miss being able to serve you at this communion table and give you the bread or hand you the cup and be able to say those sacred words to you. So many pieces that are missing. I ask my daughter, you know, what's one of the things you really miss during the COVID pandemic? And she said, yeah, you know, I really actually miss the church lunches where I could play with all my friends at church. And it was sort of heartbreaking. And I miss those too. So the contours of our faith, how we practice our faith in 2020 has really shifted, hasn't it? It's shifted. But I want to suggest to you today that maybe it's not necessarily an all bad thing, that it's really allowed us to rethink our faith and what things are really essential to our faith. It's allowed us to see if the core of our faith is healthy. And maybe God has revealed to some of you that it's not as healthy as you thought it was once some of these outward trappings of your faith have been pulled away. You know, when I'm coaching dying churches to restart, and I think many of you know that I do that work, so I've been coaching several churches, and I almost, you know, put a line in the sand and just say, you absolutely have to close your doors and get out of your sanctuary and worship just kind of in a home sort of house style worship for a while. And usually I get a lot of pushback about that because nobody wants to leave what's comfortable and familiar. But the reason that I encourage churches to do that is so that the church can discover that worship and church isn't about my preferences and what songs we sing and if we sang my hymn or didn't sing my hymn or if somebody's sitting in my pew on a Sunday morning, that God moves in ways beyond our preferences and beyond our routines and beyond our rituals and the things that we're used to. And so those churches that are trying to restart, once they go through that and they come back into the sanctuary, and by that time the things have begun to change in their church, that they're sort of primed and ready, that God moves in different directions. You know, I think that's what we're going through as a church at Northwest, is God has been showing us that he's still at work. God doesn't just dwell with inside these four walls. God isn't just waiting for you to walk back in sometime in 2021 so that he can say hello to you again. No, God is at work right now. In the late 1800s, there was a new architectural style that emerged, and it was built around this expression that form follows function. And so before that, people had built, you know, really ornate buildings, but it wasn't necessarily all that practical. But in the industrial age, late 1800s, they started building buildings and said, you know what, if this is going to be an industrial complex, we're going to design it for that reason. And if it's going to be an office complex, it's going to be designed from the ground up to meet the needs of the people that are going to be working inside of that facility. And now that concept has spread, and obviously you've undoubtedly heard that it spread to kitchen appliances and clothes and all sorts of things, that we design things thinking of the goal or the purpose. But think about the shape or the form of your faith. Think about what that looks like. The practices and the routines and the traditions that you've leaned on to practice your faith and to grow in your maturity in Christ. All of those pieces, all of those should be outward expressions of a strong inner core of faith. Because friends, at its core, faith is just simply believing in God and having a trusting, loving relationship with your Creator. As we look today at this Christmas story, we're going to see that the practices and the routines and the traditions of Israel had gotten so far removed from their trust in God. And so when Christ came on that night in Bethlehem, it was really an indictment for those that were sitting in Jerusalem expecting God to show up in the ways that they thought he should show up. And when he came, he was rejected because God didn't follow their routines and their traditions. So in their case, the form of their faith got so far away from the objective of loving and serving and following Almighty God. And so when God comes, he bypasses all of that in Jerusalem, that beautiful temple, and he basically says, no thanks. They're holding out the keys. Here's the keys to your new house, God, when you come. And God just sort of walks on by and goes to that little town of Bethlehem and says, no thanks, that he has other plans. And so let's read the story together. These are familiar words, I'm sure, but they're beautiful words. And so read with me in the second chapter of Luke. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. And so Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. And he went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, firstborn, a son, and she wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. For generations, Israel has been shaping their faith largely around the temple, hundreds of laws and traditions. But the form of their faith, the shape of their faith, didn't follow God's purposes, so that they missed him when he came. And sometimes the shape of our faith, we start leaning on so heavily that we can miss God. And during this time, as so many of those things are taken away, maybe you're feeling like, where is God? He is right there with you. I want to share just three aspects of faith that can help us as we're trying to piece together, because I think in many ways we're sort of rebuilding what our faith looks like here in 2020. And so three things I want to share out of this story today. That first, that faith is just way simpler than what you most likely think. The second thing I want to share today is that God is more approachable than you think. And then the third thing I want to share is that God uses the least likely people and blows our minds and blows away our expectations and how he works. Let's talk about the simplicity of our faith, though. I've seen a few episodes recently of the show The Crown, and I'm a sucker for anything historical. And I don't know if it's completely accurate, but there's at least some history in the show. But before she was named queen, she's moved into this home with Philip, and they've decorated it, and it's called Clarence House. And so they decorate it, and then suddenly Elizabeth's father dies, and she's declared the Queen of England. And so Winston Churchill comes to her, and she basically says, "Mr. Churchill, we are staying here at Clarence House. We're not going to move to Buckingham Palace like everybody else has done." Well, at least in the series, Churchill sort of gasps. It's unthinkable that the Queen of England would not live in this immaculate palace that was built for British royalty, that has the treasures of the royal family and priceless art and huge dining areas and huge entertaining areas and offices and all of those things. Elizabeth finally relented and said, okay, Parliament got so upset about it that she would move into Buckingham like everybody else had. So imagine when God came to this earth, Israel's Buckingham Palace was the temple. And let me give you the full scope of what that temple looked like, because I think for many of us, we sort of, you know, visualize that the temple is like, you know, some like 300-person church like we're used to, but it was much different than our experiences. The temple complex was literally 26 acres of an institution, 26 acres surrounded by these granite colonnades. The temple itself was 60 feet high, and it was placed on a hill so that even when you were coming from a distance, you could see the gold gleaming on the roof of that temple from a long way away. That's why the disciples, as they get nearer to Jerusalem, they turn to Jesus and start talking among themselves about how incredible that temple looks to them. About 35 years after Jesus dies, Jerusalem was invaded and destroyed by the Romans. And the Romans at that time, they went into the temple and basically pulled out all the treasures. And there was so much gold that practically everything was covered with either gold or silver. And there was so much gold that one historian said that the value of gold, because the market was flooded with gold after the temple was raided by the Romans, there was so much gold flooded the market that the price of gold just tanked. So if you had invested, you're in trouble. The temple complex took 42 years to build, 18,000 workers working for 42 years to build that complex. And then after the temple is fully functioning, there's 18,000 Levites, 18,000 priests that are attending and running the temple. And all throughout the year, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of devout Jews would come to visit Jerusalem and the temple. that central place of worship. So it was a building, but it was also an institution, and it was also a pretty substantial business. That there was a treasury there within the temple complex that held all of the resources, and so all of the tithes, all of the offerings that Jews were contributing from all around the Roman Empire and that area would go into the treasury. And so it was also this pretty elaborate business. So I say all of that to say to you that here is this incredible complex and systems and people that Israel has put together. That's the form of their faith. So that when you look at it, that's the shape that it looks like. And so now maybe you can understand why when God comes in the form of Jesus Christ that so many said, no way. No way you're the Messiah, because Jesus went around the temple and said, no thanks. You know, they're waiting for the Messiah to come, and the prophecies and the writings during that time said the Messiah is going to come. He's going to appear like over the temple. We know this is where he's going to come because, look, we've put all this effort and work into it. So he's got to appear here first, but he didn't. So you can understand why people were so upset when Jesus started teaching and preaching, and when people started hearing that he was claiming to be the Messiah in kind of a subtle way. The whole story that we read is just so upside down. And really, if we could boil it all down, we can see God saying, don't make this complicated, Israel. Like, you've spent 42 years making this elaborate system and all of the business of the temple and all of that, but it's not that complicated. So I'm just going to walk by that and go up to Bethlehem about 5-6 miles away, and that's going to be where the Messiah enters the world. It's a reminder, I think, that we need to hear. I love church buildings, I love traditions, I love church music, I love the practices of the church and the fellowship of the church, but those things aren't your faith. Your faith is far more simple. That's why you can practice your faith from anywhere. That's why after 9 months, our community of believers here at Northwest is still going strong, is still growing in our relationship with God, because it's not complicated. Our faith is simple. It's a relationship with God. Remember when Jesus came, they called him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. And that's the simplicity of our faith, that God longs to be with us. And when we believe in him, when we put our trust in him, we start a relationship, and we can talk to him from anywhere. We can read the words from Scripture anywhere. We can connect with two or three other believers, and the New Testament says, and anytime you do, you're going to have church right there. Like, it's just not complicated. You can come to the Lord's table by picking up simple elements in your home and gathering either virtually or with other people and experience the presence of God at his table. So if you're feeling like you're losing your faith during the season, or that you're drifting, I just want to say today that God is giving you a wake-up call to rediscover what faith is at its very core, that it's a relationship with your Creator, and that's what God most desires. And the truth is that a relationship with him is far more fulfilling than the routines and the traditions. And those routines and traditions are important. I mean, I'm not trying to talk myself out of a job here. They're important. But they aren't the core of your faith. They help you strengthen the core of your faith, but they're not the core of your faith. You know, usually this time of year, we would be making our plans and preparing to travel to either Roanoke, Virginia to see Christy's parents, or down to North Carolina to see my family. And we would, you know, get on I-66. You know, even as I say that, I think, thank God we're not going to be on I-66 on Christmas Eve or Christmas Day. Anyway, and then we'd be on I-81. And you know, those interstates, those are not, that's not our goal, is just to hang out on I-66 or 81. I mean, we don't have any nostalgia for the rest stops on interstates. We don't have any nostalgia for the shops and restaurants along the interstates. We are going with a purpose to get back to our home, back to the ones that we love, back to family. Those are avenues to get there. It's not the destination itself. And that's where we get confused at times. And that's where Israel had gotten confused, is they got mixed up, that those avenues that help them grow closer to God actually became the object of their faith. And when that happens, faith, you begin to lose your perspective with faith, and things that shouldn't matter as much begin to matter way too much. So all of the routines and the traditions that you're missing this year, they're wonderful avenues to bring you closer to God, but they're not the core of your faith. And in 2020, we're being asked to examine whether our love for God is strong enough to sustain us, even when those avenues to God are closed, or at least have temporarily closed or detour signs. Faith or trust in God is way more simple than we think. It doesn't take all of the elaborate ceremonies, and God doesn't just dwell inside the walls of a church building. Faith is far more simpler than most of us think. And second, God is more approachable than you think. And so here's why our faith is so simple. Is because God is so approachable. I mean, think about Jesus coming to this earth. He caught so many people off guard because they were expecting something far more elaborate than what actually happened on that night in Bethlehem. They expected that only those that were up to date on their tithes and offerings, only those that were the most devout followers, only those that were in prestigious positions, the teachers and the leaders, they would be the ones with the credentials to be able to have an audience with the Messiah. They would be the ones to welcome the Messiah, to have access. But go back to Luke 2 that we just read and look at some of the details that God chooses Mary and Joseph to parent his son. Two young people who are living pretty far under the radar in Nazareth, outside of the of where people of power and prestige are supposed to come from in Jerusalem. And then God comes in the most vulnerable form possible, an infant. Get that in your mind for just a moment. God as an infant. And, you know, I've had my share amount of time with infants. Infants are completely reliant on those people around them. They're not completely reliable, I can tell you that. But they're completely reliant on those around them to provide for them, to make sure that they're safe, to make sure that they're burped and changed and don't roll off the bed, you know, all of those things. And so here God comes in such a vulnerable form. He couldn't defend himself. And unless they're your own, an infant doesn't cause you any fear. If they're your own, now it's another story. It might make you shake in your boots. But if you approach an infant, I mean, there's nothing threatening about an infant, is there? They don't have the ability to hurt you. There's no pretensions. You don't have to dress up. They don't care what you look like. I mean, you could be a hardened criminal and approach a child, and they don't care. Like, they're just going to love you and smile for you. And that's how God comes to our world, in the form of this infant, so that even the shepherds are able to approach without even thinking about it. Stepping into the presence of God. I mean, it's just unthinkable. Once Jesus begins his ministry, we begin to see that the structure of the temple and all of those religious institutions, they were really as much about keeping people out of the kingdom of God as they were about drawing people into the kingdom of God. And so this Christmas story is a reminder that, as John says in John, the first chapter, that Jesus came not to be locked away behind some doors of a palace or a temple, but Jesus came to be among us. And the literal translation in John 1 is that Jesus came and pitched his tent among us, that he has moved into the neighborhood, that he wants to be accessible, he wants to be approachable. In 1 Corinthians 3, Paul talks about the need to feed new believers spiritual milk, but the goal is that you would move eventually onto real food. And I know a lot of Christ followers who get, you know, really dependent on pastors to tell them what the Bible says and what God is like and to pray for them or with them. But if you only experience God through a pastor, then you're going to be severely restricted because there's only one of me. And so it's like a funnel, right? God's design is that all of us would be connecting with God because he is approachable. You don't have to have a divinity degree from a seminary to approach God or to open his word and to discover who he is. My goal as a pastor is just to help you connect directly to God, to help you learn that scripture is approachable and to give you some ways of reading it and studying it and to help you look at our culture through the lens of scripture. So if you somehow have gotten the idea that you can only experience God through sitting in a pew or through relying on a pastor, then I want to encourage you that God is much more approachable than you think. He invites you to come. His coming is an invitation to come to the manger because he wants to connect with you. He wants you to talk to him and pray simple, honest prayers, just like you're talking to another person. He wants you to open his word and to hear directly from him. And God isn't held captive, as I said before, by the walls of any church. And he is right there with you right now, whether you're in your home or in your living room or in your vehicle, wherever you're at, God is there. He has come to be among us. He's pitched his tent in our neighborhood. He is there. He's approachable. And he's saying, come and search for me and you'll find me because I want to be found by you. We see in scripture in another place. Well, the third thing I want to share before I close is that God works in some surprising and unexpected ways. And I know you've been hearing me say this over and over again throughout this pandemic. But I want to encourage you that God is at work even when we think he's not, or even when it seems like the most unexpected time, right? I know you might be asking, where's God at in the midst of all of this? Everything shifted, everything's changed. Where is God? He is right in the midst of all of you. He is there. He is working. And in fact, as I've said many times to you from this pulpit, this place, is that he does some of his best work in those difficult places where we don't see him or we don't think he's at work. Those are the places that God accomplishes some of the most radical transformation of our lives and of the lives of other believers around us. I know right now we need God to surprise us. We need him to work in some unexpected ways. I've heard, you know, from many of you that you're longing for the day when we'll be back in worship, when we'll have, you know, some sense of normalcy. And I get that. I want that as well. I desire that. But here's what I want to say. Don't start waiting to strengthen your relationship with God for when things are back to normal. Don't start waiting to live or waiting to grow in your faith when things are back to normal because God wants to do some stuff right now in your life. And in fact, I think he wants to do some stuff now that he probably can't do when things are normal. And you've heard me say before, too, that normal is just a setting on the dryer. I mean, what really is normal, right? But you might be missing God right now because you're waiting for God to work in a normal way again. I just want to say, you know what? Drop the expectations and start looking for God because he is at work all around you. Instead of waiting to get back to normal, I just want to encourage you to lean into God and what he's doing in the here and in the now. And maybe for some of you, enough things have been stripped away from you that you've begun to realize that, you know, my faith just isn't as strong as I thought it was, or I need to really strengthen and beef up my relationship with God because these are some tough times. You realize that the avenues that had helped guide you into the presence of God, now that those avenues have some temporarily closed signs on them, that the core of your faith isn't as strong as you thought it was. And God is saying, you know what? It's just keep it simple and come back to me and come rediscover who I am. Approach the manger. Open your mouth and just speak to me as you would a close friend. And so maybe today as you're watching this service, God is just speaking to you and drawing you into his presence. Just to stop waiting for life to change and to get back to normal. And to right now, even in this difficult spot, to rediscover who God is. And then maybe some of you have been pushed to your breaking point in 2020. And for the first time ever, you didn't think you needed God before, but God is showing you in some not so subtle ways that you do need a Savior. And I'm happy to tell you that there is a Savior, that there is someone who forsook his status and came to this earth and died on a cross for our sins to save us because we need a Savior. And you need a Savior. And maybe these last several months have shown you that you do need a Savior, that you need something bigger, higher than yourself to get you out of the mess that you find yourself in. And his invitation is going out again today to come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And so maybe today is the day, because God is right there, and I believe he's speaking to you right now. Maybe today is the day to say, God, I've never said it before, but it's time now just to say that I repent for not following your ways and all the things that I've done that displease you. And then I believe that Jesus, you're the Son of God, and I want to give my life to you, and I want you to be the Lord of my life. I want you to lead me because I've made a mess of things, and so it's time for the Savior to step in. This whole year might feel completely upside down, but God is at work. Would you just repeat that with me, because it helps when you say it out loud. God is at work. Just one more time. God is at work. Would you just listen for his voice today? Would you just look for him at work? And this week, we've been having a challenge throughout the season of Advent. This week, I want to challenge you to spend just 10 minutes with God, just creating some space. And there's really, you know, there's nothing magical about this. What I'm asking you to do is just to position yourself to be able to hear and to be able to see him this week. And maybe some of you are already doing that. You already have your routines. That's great. But maybe others, life has just sort of gotten so distracting and carried you in so many different directions that I want to challenge you to pick up God's word and spend time speaking to him. And so we're going to send out just a series of simple devotions on Sunday night, tonight. But there's so many other resources on Bible apps and websites that you could get devotional resources. There's a link, I think it's still there, on our e-news, a direct link to Daily Bread, which is a wonderful little daily devotion, free online. So many ways just to kind of pause and position yourself before God to hear from him. And this week, my prayer is that you have some God sightings, that God just shows up and that he reminds you that he's there, that he's at work, that he's approachable, and that a time that's just felt so complicated and a time that's felt so unsettling that you just kind of return to center and realize that faith really is that simple. It's about that relationship with God. And that relationship with God has widespread implications in terms of our relationship with others, but that's very core is that relationship with God. That's where it starts. And so I'm praying this week that you hear from God, and I want to pray for you right now. God, thank you for this story, and thank you for the surprising ways that you work in our world. God, you didn't have to come, but you did. You didn't have to come down and pitch your tent among us, but you did. We remember the time that Satan took Jesus up onto the Temple Mount and said, just jump off, and really tempted Jesus to use that temple complex to show his power, but you already had that power. You could have already forced us to follow you. You could have already come and set up shop and been the God behind the impenetrable gates that only a select few could enter and approach, but you didn't. You came in the form of a baby that's so approachable. God, I just pray that this Christmas, this very different Christmas where things are upside down, that we would look back when hopefully the pandemic is in the rearview mirror at some point, that we would be able to look back and see that, God, you were working and moving, and maybe we couldn't see it in the moment, but you were there. And maybe for some of you, it was even the moment that you gave your life to him. God, we will ourselves, even if we're not feeling like saying it right now, we will ourselves just to say, we trust you. We trust you that you're at work. We trust you because you've been faithful to us in the past, and you're not going to fail us now. As Jeremiah wrote, that we are loved with an everlasting love, with an everlasting love. And you're not done with us yet. God, when all of these avenues have been closed that we're used to using to come into your presence, when all those avenues have been closed, we just realize that it's an opportunity that you're wanting us to connect with you in some new ways and to rediscover what worship is and rediscover who you are. And God, we can talk about it, and it all sounds great and fine, but until we position ourselves and take action, it's still just a thought. It's still just a good idea. I pray, God, that idea moves into some reality this week, that it moves into some dedicated time that we spend experiencing your presence. God, we recognize in this pandemic that many are hurting, that many are in trouble. God, even within our church, Lord, we pray over every person that's just wrestling with darkness and doubts and anxiety from all of these changes. I just pray for healing, and that your peace would fall on all of those that are listening to my voice today. God, I pray for those whose life has been upended through the loss of a job and situations have changed. God, that you would show up, that you would provide, that you would take care. And God, we will give you praise. We will not forget what you're doing in 2020. We will not forget that you've sustained us and you've kept us, even through a very dark year. God, thanks for hearing our prayer. In the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Friends, let's continue to worship with that beautiful old song, What Child Is This? Done in a little bit different style this year, but let's worship together. Ooh.
rest on Mary's lap is sleeping. Whom angels greet with anthem sweet, while shepherds watch our keeping. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds God and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. Why lies he in such mean estate, where ox and ass are feeding? The Christian fear for sinners here, the silent word is beating. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds God and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. So bring him incense, gold and myrrh, come peasant king to own him. The King of Kings salvation brings, let loving hearts enthrone him. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds God and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds God and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. Mary.
All right. Who knew that Johnny had some scatting skills going on there? Nicely done, Johnny. We had a lot of fun playing this week together. Thanks to Will and Johnny for your work and to all of our worship team that's been just extraordinarily committed during this time. Hey, before we close, I want to share just a few things happening in the life of our church. First, we have an Advent photo challenge going on. So every week, as we light a new candle of Advent, today's the candle of joy, we're asking you to post pictures on your Facebook account that remind you of joy, that are something about that image spurs joy in you. And you can put the hashtag NW Advent Challenge, hashtag NW Advent Challenge, and we'll be able to see all of those that are posted throughout the church on Facebook. We are having a talent show again this year. Now, we kind of had a mini one last year, but we've done this for several years, and this year, we'll try to do something that we have done before. So we're asking you to send us videos, and this is for adults or kids. And so you can sing a song or play an instrument, or if you have some special gift or talent, we're asking you to keep it to about 3 minutes and send that to us. And we're going to have live streamed show on December 20th, right after worship. So this will be next week, right after worship. We'll air that at around 11:30 on that Sunday, and you'll be able to see all of those videos compiled. I already have some thoughts about what the Turners are going to do, so we're excited about that. Hey, this could be really fun, but it's going to take you getting involved. And so I know we're all crazy busy, but would you just give some happiness and joy to others by sharing a gift or ability with the church? You can send those by email to us. If the file's too big, send us a note. We have a file sharing website that will help you share larger files. So send it to us. You can send it to connect@thenorthwestchurch.com. You can send it to connect@thenorthwestchurch.com. And then finally, we'd been going back and forth, hoping to maybe do an outdoor Christmas Eve service, but with the rising COVID numbers, we just think that's not wise to do at this point. So we're going to do a virtual Christmas Eve service. It's going to be available for you to stream anytime on December 24th. And so whether you want to do that in the morning or in the evening, depending on your plans with your family and friends, you can pull that up. It's going to be a shorter service, about 30 minutes, but just as a way to kind of focus and remind you of the true meaning of Christmas. Get a candle ready. We usually end our Christmas Eve services with a little candle lighting ceremony as we pass that flame around the sanctuary here. But we'll do that virtually this year. So get a candle ready, and let's get ready to celebrate on December 24th. Those are your announcements for today. So as you prepare to go, I just want to pray that the Lord would bless you and keep you, that the Lord would make his face to shine upon you, that the Lord would lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Go in peace, and go in peace to see God at work in your life. Have a great week. We'll see you next week for the fourth Sunday of Advent. Friends, Christmas is just around the corner. God bless you all.